Everybody wake up! Hibernation's over!
Oh, morning!
Morning, Hammy.
Animals are in the house.
Well, it's been a dream project for me. I knew about the comic strip before we'd even optioned it as a feature film. Over the Hedge is written and drawn by a pair of amazingly talented guys. Mike Fry writes the strip and T. Lewis illustrates it.
A comic strip, very simply and very brilliantly, has a turtle and a raccoon who peer over a hedge and take a look at human society and all of the very, very strange things that we do as human beings. And absolutely lampoons it with razor-sharp wit. This felt like a great arena in which to set an animated film.
Uh-huh.
It's a classic Laurel and Hardy kind of team.
Yeah, they sort of complete each other, I guess.
Yeah, and visually, I sort of fashioned them. I kind of had Winnie the Pooh and Piglet, that kind of size relationship in mind when drawing them.
Mike, as a writer, just knows how to work in that tiny, impossible format of set up a joke, develop it, pay it off with a punchline, and then cap it. T. Lewis's beautiful drawings, I mean, I liken him to the classic comic strip illustrators. He's a pen and ink guy, and the thick and thin and vibrancy of his line, the expressions of his characters, it was an incredible challenge to try to capture the sort of personalities that he has in his black and white drawn world in our three-dimensional color world and try to stay true to them. I believe that what we have is, of course, a very different looking set of animals than what was drawn in the strip, but because we work so closely with T, I think that we've got the same tone and the same sort of irreverent fun to the style of what we have.
Jeepers. The way that the Mike and T, they do little vignettes or moments, and I think the challenge for us was to actually take that and turn it into a feature-length, you know, storytelling.
What we're going for here is a vicious, man-eating rabid squirrel. Can you handle that?
Excuse me?
Yes. Hemi.
rabbits aren't vicious. They're all cute and cuddly, so.
Rabid, not rabbit.
Oh.
It's always a pretty big leap when you go from a drawing to a 3D character, and perhaps even a larger leap when you go from the beautiful line quality of T. Lewis's cartoon strip illustrations into something that is so fleshed out and furred as our CG characters.
What is that?
For Over the Hedge, it was really about backyard animals. What are their habits and what do they do is to have a semblance of realism, have a believability. And I think it's important for the artist to sort of be in touch or, you know, find out a little bit more about those worlds in order to bring that element of believability to the film. The San Diego Zoo brought a number of the animals up to actually the DreamWorks campus on a day. And they brought a raccoon and possum and turtle and all the different animals that we have in the film and allowed the crew to observe them and talk about them and again, figure out what their habits were.
When we brought the animals to the studio, they sort of shocked us because we'd spent a lot of time designing these exquisitely stylized and beautiful characters. And when the real thing showed up, which we're supposed to be improving on, they were so much cuter than what we'd been working on. We had to take like 7 steps backwards and take a look at the real thing and go, okay, this thing's really cute already. What are we gonna do to make it at least that cute in the film? So we went back, redesigned them, gave them a little bit more more appeal that was directly inspired from like the little baby possums that we were holding in our hands or the skunks or whatever it was.
All right, kids, you heard your mother, and now you listen to me. Shape up there.
Trying to like celebrate the differences between the characters as opposed to just, you know, blanket styling them with something.
The most difficult thing for the character TDs is trying to imagine how is this going to move? How is this character going to move? In the case of RJ, you have this very sly, very slippery sort of moving character that should be very mobile and very able to move, climb trees, do all sorts of things.
Play?
Wipe,
down, boy, sit, roll over.
We are looking at the anatomy of that character and trying to see where should those bones be? Where should the muscles be? What should the arm look like when it bends or the hands and down to the details of the face? And when you're trying to put in all those details and try to make it anatomically correct and then have it be believable when they're acting and so that they still emote properly.
When the shot comes to us in our department, basically it's gone through modeling, the characters are built, And there's a layout department that brings everything together into a shot. So you have your characters, you have your props, you have your environment. And so we bring the life to the characters and give them their personalities.
Okay, that's it. I am sick and tired of everybody taking one look at me and running away because they think I'm filthy.
We use the actors' voices in the shot when we're actually working. So we're playing to the dialogue directly from Gary Shandling and Bruce Willis and the whole crew. Gary Shandling has a lot of things where he puts his hands to his head, and we tend to get a lot of that type of stuff. Facial expressions on Bruce Willis is a big thing because he expresses himself facially.
That stuff is to die for!
My role on Over the Hedge was to implement the first faces for the first characters. I started with RJ, and the reason we always start with the star is because we have to be able to prove that the character is going to be able to carry the show.
Bingo! Okay, step two.
I thought we'd be dead by step two, so this is going great.
There's a lot of breakthroughs that we're looking at in Over the Hedge we're really proud of. Mostly we have fur. We have fur everywhere. We have fur on the humans in that they have hair. Every one of our characters not only has fur, but they have a different sort of texture or softness. Look, if you will, at the sort of soft, downy fur on the possum's chest. It feels so tactile, it's like you want to touch that fur. Look at the more coarse, rougher fur on RJ the raccoon. Take a look at the thick spines of the quills on the porcupines. It's like we not only had to invent fur for the movie, we had to invent a whole palette and range and world of what fur could do on this picture.
One of the biggest things that we did was, as a character like RJ has any movement, his hair is following his movement. That's very unusual. You don't find that in a lot of CG films right now. Not only did we find a great solution for that, but we were able to implement it across all of our furry characters so that all hair moves and all fur moves. Now, that's a huge win. The other thing is that when characters interact with each other and hands touch fur, mostly people avoid that because you have to actually move the fur. Our guide hair solution allowed the character effects department to have characters interact with props and they could move the fur away from the prop. A character could touch another character on the arm. They could move the fur away from it penetrating the fingers. So we had an unusual situation where we could take fur to the next level. It wasn't just a lot of fur done well, and we think it's been done well, but it's fur done well that moves.
Oh. Oh, what was it? Wait, right on the tip of my tongue!
The mandate for the effects on this is to be funny whenever possible. That in live action, it's usually about realism. Here, it's about how do we exaggerate it.
There's a lot of fun effects to keep your eye open for. Some of them are so subtle that you probably won't see them, but were incredibly difficult. The animals interact with the world of the forest. That's leaves and grass that they have to step on and have to bend and follow through. It's the kind of thing the eye probably doesn't notice, but if it wasn't there, you would surely miss a sort of richness in the world. All the way up to our most outlandish effects, we actually ignite a barbecue propane tank, which propels a rocket-like sled full of food up into the air. It's a beautiful sort of fun tribute to the Apollo or Space Shuttle program when that thing lifts off and leaves a plume of white smoke. We've got simple things like backyard sprinklers. Whoa. That you take for granted every day as very, very difficult and challenging special effects to get water to spray up in the air. Some of our special effects are actually our biggest joke in the film. So when RJ opens up a bag of nacho cheese chips, the cheese dust explodes out of it. And from the animal's point of view, it's the most amazing thing they've ever smelled, the most amazing thing they've ever tasted. And the special effect of this wave, this explosion of orange dust, is one of the funniest moments in the picture.
How great I am.
I'm incredibly excited about the music. We have put together a trio that really spans the gamut of experience. They are Hans Zimmer, who is obviously one of the top composers in working in film today, working with Rupert Gregson-Williams. And then to top that all off, someone that Tim and I have long been a fan of, we were able to get him on this movie, and that's Ben Folds. Ben is an outstanding singer-songwriter in terms of the level of sophistication that he brings to his music and his lyrics in particular.
How great I am. Gotta tell myself, yeah, I'm the man. Looks grim right now. Pretty soon we'll be laughing about it. Ooh, and it's all right.
I think the challenge is not to just do a standard score. I could just jump in and do a beautiful little orchestral sweet score, because it's quite sweet. They're in the forest, make a nice sweet little sound. But with Ben's sound, we can make something a little bit different, a bit more rock and roll.
It's a particular place, suburbia, and it's really interesting to figure out what its sound is.
I felt like, there's lots of blue suburban skies and a lot of suburbia, and that was the first thing I was drawn to visually, and so Hans and Rupert and I kind of came up with this sort of vocal, using vocals instead of strings to make it surreal.
You've got a crew of over 200 artists. Every one of them every day will show you some amazing drawing or piece of animation or lighting or special effect. Every one of them is at the top of their game and showing you things for you to help them craft all of these different parts to make one whole, to make one film.
Oh, we have so much work to do.
To watch your five-year-old daughter go around attempting to burp her ABCs.
I can burp my ABCs!
A, B, Z.
Emmy!
Is both exciting and slightly revolting at the same time.
Thank you.
It's not just for kids. The animation is phenomenal. It's so rich and so vibrant. And there's so many layers to it. And I think it's a great cast and a hilarious movie.
Was that out loud?
It really does address a lot of human foibles and kind of makes fun at them and holds a mirror up to humans and society in general that I think everybody's going to find funny.
How many humans fit in there?
Usually one. Whoa, stop. That's it. Ladies and gentlemen, our work here is done.